Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Adventure Gap, Changing the Face of the Outdoors, 10th Anniversary Edition, by James Edward Mills. Foreword by Shelton Johnson. Narrated by James Edward Mills. To Ruby and Billy, for making the sacrifices and enduring the struggles of your time so that I can always pursue my dreams, no matter how foolish or frivolous. Thank you, Mom and Dad. To Shemaine, after 25 years of marriage, your love and support have made possible every adventure. I am who I am because of you. Foreword. As a kid growing up in Detroit, I knew about Althea Gibson, Muhammad Ali, Wilt Chamberlain, Wilma Rudolph, Willie Mays, and Jesse Owens. But I never heard anything about Charlie Crenshaw. He was a pioneer in a sport that none of my childhood friends ever talked about, mountain climbing. As children, we never saw African Americans in the movies climbing mountains. We saw Clint Eastwood in The Iger Sanction. Yet, had I known then what I know now, I would have been upset that the lead character was played by Eastwood and not Jim Brown. There were African American alpinists at the time, but you wouldn't have known it unless you were one of them. It's obvious that we can be influenced by who we see in the media and what we see them doing on screen and in print. But impressionable youth can also be shaped by what they don't see African Americans doing much of, including kayaking, backpacking, skiing, mountain biking, horseback riding, and mountain climbing. I went on to become a Park Service Ranger, but it wasn't because there were role models for me when I was a child. Robert Stanton, who would eventually become the first African-American director of the National Park Service, was already a park ranger when I was still young. But no one ever told me about him at the time, and I never read about him in newspapers or magazines or saw him on television. And that's a shame. Stanton broke through barriers as the first black director of our national parks, and more of our youth should be aware of his great accomplishment. That's why James Mills's Adventure Gap is such an important book. Besides being well-written, insightful, dramatic, and often lyrical, it is also essential for anyone who desires a more complete vision of who is experiencing the great outdoors and the achievements of African Americans historically and today. The wilderness experience shaped the American character, and Africans in America were an integral part of that national story. Many people today have heard of Jedediah Smith and Jim Bridger. They were Euro-American trappers who have since attained legendary status. But during that same time period, there were also African-American mountain men like James P. Beckworth and Edward Rose. Unfortunately, Beckworth and Rose never became part of popular culture. If they had, perhaps more African-American kids today would be inspired to follow in their footsteps and explore the deserts, plains, grasslands, and mountains that constitute a collective heritage that is as much African as it is European. The Adventure Gap tells the story of Expedition Denali, a unique all-African-American climbing team of which young people of every background should be aware. The team's members push themselves physically, emotionally, and spiritually to achieve something not just for themselves, but for all of us. Through their act, we can see that public lands and wilderness belong to all Americans. Their ascent of the highest peak in North America makes the statement that the pursuit of happiness for a people brought to these shores in bondage must of necessity lead to a mountaintop. In the late 1960s, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. spoke metaphorically about his own journey to the mountaintop and his vision of the promised land. Anyone who has stood at the rim of the Grand Canyon or on the top of Half Dome in Yosemite, or on the lip of the Upper Geyser Basin in Yellowstone, has seen a view as real and as sublime as any in this world. When we as African Americans explore deep caverns, or raft wild rivers, or climb big mountains, we extend the civil rights movement vertically and horizontally to encompass all that's wild in America. And we claim our full inheritance as citizens of this country. We are saying that we are Americans. James's book is not simply a chronicle of an expedition to the top of Denali. It is an account of a door being pushed open that had been locked shut and barricaded. The wind blowing through that doorway has the sweetness of mountains about it, but it is cold. The night is upon us, but the stars will light the way. Take their hands. Hold on to Erica, Shob, Billy, Scott, Adina, Tyree, DeBerry, Ryan, Rosemary, the other courageous members of Expedition Denali, and James, who brought their story to us. Together, we will all climb that high peak. Together, we will find the Promised Land. Shelton Johnson, Mariposa, California, June 2014. Prologue. Mount Baker. Mount Baker, Washington, August 13, 2012. It was 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a beautiful summer's day. Exhausted, I slept in a crumpled heap as warm rays of sunlight shone through the open door and gently swept away the chill of a mountainside covered in ice and snow. You were just lying there in your tent, outside of your sleeping bag, fully clothed, face down like you were dead, laughed Adina Scott. You even still had your boots on. Our team had just summited Mount Baker, and it was true. I was totally wiped out after the long walk back across the Eastern Glacier. Once inside our base camp perimeter, safe from the risk of a crevasse fall, I had dropped my pack, untied my rope, and helped to stow away the group gear. I had somehow managed to get my crampons off, letting them fall beside my ice axe and helmet in a pile of snow. Then I had crawled inside my tent and collapsed into a deep, deep sleep. That evening, over a sparse meal of rehydrated beans and makeshift quesadillas, my teammates enjoyed a good laugh at my expense. I laughed right along with them. I couldn't help it, even though the climb had in fact taken quite a toll. I felt totally spent, beaten near to death. Even as a climber with more than a few years of mountaineering under my belt, I could not remember the last time I had ever felt so physically wiped out. But if my fellow climbers could have seen my face buried under the nylon folds of my down jacket as I slept, they would have seen that I was smiling. Despite the pain I felt in my aching joints, I enjoyed a feeling of supreme satisfaction. Having gotten up well before dawn to scramble across acres of rock and ice and pushing myself harder than ever before, I was on the path of something truly wonderful. And yet, even then, despite my efforts to get this far, deep inside, I knew my role as a climber on this team was coming to an end. In camp that evening, I thought back to 3 days earlier. Straining against the weight of our heavy packs, we had hiked in along a dirt trail lined with trees and scattered with pine needles. Was it really just 3 days ago? As always happens in climbing, time on the mountain intensifies, and I felt that I had been immersed in this adventure for much longer. For the summit bid, we were 13 members in all, in two teams. Seven were students of the National Outdoor Leadership School, NOLS, there to learn with two instructors to guide us on a rope descent of Mount Baker, the second most glaciated mountain in the United States outside of Alaska. The other four, NOLS instructors as well, came as a media team, armed with cameras and microphones to document our climb as we aimed to make history. Climbing Mount Baker was the second of several training missions to put the first majority team of African Americans on the summit of the highest peak in North America, an ambitious project called Expedition Denali. In a world where far too few people of color spend time recreating outdoors, our mission was to demonstrate that despite all evidence to the contrary, Black folks do indeed climb. Though I was immensely proud to be in the group and committed to doing my part, on this trip, I was also struggling. Growing up, I had successfully climbed several of the high peaks in the San Gabriel and San Bernardino Mountains near my childhood home in Los Angeles, and I had climbed a few routes of vertical rock in Yosemite in 2005 and 2006. My climbing days since had been few and far between. My last effort was in 2010 when I tagged along with professional climber Micah Burhart to Ethiopia, where I helped her set up a series of small scrambles on the Giralta Massif near the village of Tigray. Over the years as a professional journalist, I had interviewed several leading alpinists such as Ed Viesters, Peter Athens, Steve House, and Hillary O'Neill. I've gotten to know big-name rock climbers Lynn Hill, Ron Kalk, Alex Honnold, and Tommy Caldwell. And I've met Royal Robbins and Yvon Chouinard, living legends of mountaineering. For the past 20 years, I had been a tangential part of the climbing community, but with few notable accomplishments of my own. At the ripe old age of 46, the challenges I faced on Mount Baker had nothing to do with my race and everything to do with the simple fact that I was out of shape. On the first day, even as we sucked down the relatively rich air just a few thousand feet above sea level, it was clear that I was out of my depth. I had started to lag behind as we climbed slowly above the tree line and onto the first of several snowfields. Wearing a new pair of boots, I realized was a rookie move, and my feet were now plagued with blisters, two of them the size of silver dollars. An old injury from a fall 20 years earlier nagged my left hip, causing me to limp. I could do nothing but endure the pain as we kicked steps into the trail ahead. The path was slippery, with a combination of ankle-deep snow and bare rocky ground, which made it that much harder to carry 50 pounds of personal gear, climbing equipment, and food on my back. I'd studied the maps, and I knew we had several miles to go before we reached the Eastern Glacier, in the spot 8,000 feet above sea level that would serve as our first camp. From the moment I had heard about Expedition Denali, I was determined to be a part of it, including this training climb of Mount Baker. But on a rest break, as I sat panting and drenched in sweat, I wondered whether I was in over my head. As if on cue, one of the strongest members of our team came up to me and asked, "You want me to take some of your weight?" I knew then that I was not alone in that wondering. Adina moves over mountain terrain like an elfin princess right out of Tolkien. I must outweigh her by 40 pounds, but this 32-year-old doctor of engineering has the carrying capacity and dexterity of a Peruvian llama. I reluctantly handed over a snow picket and an avalanche probe from the group gear I carried. They weren't the heaviest items in my pack by any means, but giving them up was a formal concession of my inability to carry my fair share as part of the team. The symbolism wasn't wasted on me. I had to do better. As I trudged further up the snowfield, each step was like taking a blow to the shins with a 2x4. Every 10 paces or so, I'd stop, lean into my trekking poles, and take a dozen deep breaths. The rest of the team was out of sight over the next ridge as I plodded along, alone in the mountain wilderness. By this time, we were all well above treeline, and I found myself surrounded by a glaring landscape of white snow set against a crystal blue sky. Slabs of bare granite poked through to reveal sparse patches of vegetation defying the ice that lingered despite the summer season. Sweat poured into my eyes, and the sting of perspiration made it difficult to see, and nearly impossible to appreciate, the beauty all around me. Eventually, I caught up to one of the Knowles instructors, who asked if I had eaten anything. When I answered no, he made me take off my pack and choke down some food and water. I should know better, I told myself. I have to keep refueling. I was more out of practice than I'd realized. We sat there chatting while I ate and drank. I was grateful for the distraction of conversation and the comfort of compassion. I could feel my strength slowly rebounding when our course leader, Angela Patnode, came back over the ridge, retracing her steps through the snow. "We're setting up camp over there," she said, pointing with the thumb over her shoulder. "I'm going to take your pack." I would have been foolish to say no. She'd already dropped her pack back at camp, so I transferred mine to her back and followed as she ascended the ridge. After scrambling over a rocky outcropping, we found ourselves in a big patch of open ground at the very edge of the glacier. Pockets of heather and wildflowers colored the landscape with splashes of green, yellow, and purple, throwing into contrast the white background of our objective, a maze of crevasses and ice walls at the base of Mount Baker. Up ahead, I could see the rest of our team setting up tents and making camp. Angela handed me back my pack. A life coach from Montana, she was sensitive to the delicate psychology of failure. With my burden of weight, she passed back to me the dignity of walking the final steps to Cragview under my own power. Once again, the message was clear. I had to do better. Mountaineering is perhaps life's greatest metaphor. As we overcome the physical obstacles of dangerously low temperatures and high altitude, We not only push past our own physical limits, but redefine the way we relate to the world and gain along the way a deeper understanding of ourselves. Mountains are like a three-dimensional relief map of the human spirit that illustrates the heights of our aspirations and the depths of our despair. As we travel into them, struggling through the uncertain ether of danger, and enduring the cold and limb-numbing fatigue, we can't help but reflect on our lives, the decisions we've made, and where we might be today if we'd taken a different path. The mountain experience affects not only our reflections on the past, but also influences the way we think about the future. It allows us to realign our priorities and consider life from a new perspective. And even though this is a story based in fact, there's a spiritual transformation that occurs between fantasy and reality that lies at the heart of every adventure. At 20,237 feet above sea level, Denali, formerly called Mount McKinley, is the loftiest perch in the United States. As one of the so-called seven summits, the tallest peak on each continent, Denali is a much-valued prize on most climbers' bucket lists. Both physically and metaphorically, if you can succeed on Denali, you can likely succeed anywhere. By summiting this high mountain, the members of the Expedition Denali team wanted to show that people of color, African Americans in particular, do, in fact, have a place in outdoor recreation. The objective was to inspire a new generation of minority youth to seek out and enjoy a relationship with the natural world where they might come to play, pursue career opportunities, and fight for its long-term preservation. Like most climbing expeditions, the summit was not the sole goal. And for this expedition in particular, the ascent of the summit would only be the first step. The journey would continue for the climbers back home in their communities, where each team member would be responsible for sharing their experience and offering encouragement to those around them who aspire to a life of adventure. For these noble intentions, I wanted to be part of Expedition Denali. But my interest in mountaineering was indeed no more selfless than that of any other climber who ever lived. I wanted to join because I love the sport of climbing, the physical exertion, the view from the summit, and the sense of accomplishment that comes only from achieving a high peak. These self-serving human motives are typical of those who risk alienating friends, family, and fortune to become, as the writer Lionel Terry describes in his book of the same title, a conquistador of the useless. Climbing is a pastime available primarily to those with the disposable income and leisure time to squander on an activity that has virtually no social redeeming qualities. That's probably why I, along with many other men and women around the world, enjoy it so much. Climbing is the very definition of freedom. My interest in climbing is also professional. As an outdoor journalist, I enjoy traveling to distant places to tell the stories of others in pursuit of their dreams. I like discovering what motivates climbers to do the things they do. And I want to encourage my audience to achieve audacious goals of their own. Yet in recent years, I had felt my personal life falling short of the spirit of adventure I aimed to inspire in others. That persistent pain in my left hip had curtailed my physical activity, and I needed a physical challenge of consequence to aspire to, something that truly mattered. Expedition Denali sounded like just the thing. Still, climbing the highest peak in North America was only part of my objective. My bigger goal was to better understand why so few people who look like me, African Americans, seek out adventure in the natural world, whether by striding along a forest trail or tramping up an icy glacier. To tell that story well, I also needed to test myself. Although I'd spent plenty of time in the outdoors, it's one thing to get away from it all. It's quite another to press the boundaries of your soul and resist what 10 million years of evolution have taught you to fear: hunger, cold, isolation, falling, by climbing a high peak. I believe we experience genuine freedom when we make a conscious choice to set aside the comforts of warmth, family, and financial security just to climb to a high place and enjoy the view of a distant horizon. Though we live in a nation whose founding principle is freedom, far too many of us deprive ourselves of the opportunity to get beyond our daily urban routine to gaze upon the grandeur of the natural world. And too many of us depriving ourselves of nature are people of color. 2 days after my initial poor performance, I felt a great deal stronger. It was the day before our summit bid, and I woke up feeling ready to go. Applying the lessons I had learned about the importance of balancing rest with plenty of food and water, I began our ascent to our next bivvy, a flat expanse of ice at the base of Mount Baker, on a full stomach. Earlier that morning, I polished off a full breakfast of pancakes slathered in a syrupy mixture of brown sugar melted with thick gobs of butter and washed down with rich hot chocolate. Weighed down with 3 liters of drinking water, I humped the load feeling lighter on my feet, with the full confidence that this time I wouldn't bonk. And indeed, once I got going, I noticed that my pace had improved dramatically. The long, steep climb up the snow-covered glacier held the combined challenge and advantage of a path carved by my teammates' boots plunged deep into the snow, one after the other. Just swing your leg with the momentum of your boot and plant it. Shift your weight over your foot and rest, Adina said. Take your next step and don't apologize to anyone for your pace. Raised in the Pacific Northwest, Adina was thoroughly at home in the Cascade Mountains. She learned the art of glacier travel at a young age from her father, now a professor emeritus of mathematics at the University of Washington in Tacoma. Decades before, he had ventured west from his home in Philadelphia and fallen in love with the high mountains, later instilling in his children a strong appreciation for the outdoors and wonders of nature. Adina was a strong and able mountaineer. Despite the heavy load of her pack and the rough terrain, she moved with a grace and ease I admired. Perhaps for the first time, I recognized the value of gaining a talented mentor to help guide my own practice in climbing. Despite my years of experience in the mountains, as I watched Adina move and make decisions, I realized that I still had a lot to learn. Up and along the upper edge of the glacier, we marched with a steady rhythm, choreographed to each intake of breath and each beat of our hearts. Though we were roped together in teams of three, we moved as one unit, united in our objective to reach the summit. "You're doing much better today," Angela told me when we stopped for a rest. "How do you feel?" "Good," I replied. "It helps to have my tanks full. I feel stupid for not eating the other day." She smiled sardonically with a nod that said, "No shit, knucklehead." After dinner, as evening slowly fell over our camp, we gathered as a team. The plan was to head out well before dawn the following morning to make our bid for the summit. When our departure time was announced, 3 a.m., the others probably shared my first thought. "Are you freaking kidding me?" But no one said anything. We just agreed to be roped up and ready to go. One by one, we shuffled off to bed, each of us mentally preparing to roll out of camp in what many of us would still consider the middle of the night. Hours later, I lay in my tent, still wide awake, huddled against the cold. I was shivering, but only in part as a result of the temperature. After all, in midsummer, the pre-dawn chill was well below freezing. I shook as much in nervous anticipation of what lay ahead. Around 1:30 in the morning, I crawled out of my sleeping bag to pee. Since my alarm was set for 2, I decided not to go back to sleep and instead passed the time firing up the stove to melt snow into drinking water. Others roused themselves slowly, fighting to get their bodies moving after too little sleep, and started making their own breakfast. By the light of headlamps in the otherwise total darkness, we put on our gear, complete with crampons and ice axes. Shortly after the appointed hour, we marched out of camp in rope teams of 3. As we walked through the night up the eastern glacier, my headlamp restricted my field of vision to a bright white cone of light. Overnight, the summer slush further up the mountain had frozen to hard and slippery ice. The sharp spikes of our crampons were the only thing keeping us from losing our footing and then sliding down the mountain, past our base camp, all the way back to Cragview. As I walked steadily forward, my worldview comprised nothing more than a coil of rope, the toes of my boots, and the blue-gray footprints of the climbers on lead ahead of me. As I plodded on through the darkness, nothing else mattered but the satisfying snick that sounded each time I kicked steel into snow. It was a walk of faith, and one that demanded my full concentration. Despite the light from our headlamps, Billy Long and Tyree Moore, the other 2 members of my rope team, were all but invisible. Last in line, I used the rope to pace myself, walking just fast enough to keep the rope slack, but careful not to step on it. I also had to be careful not to let it pull tight and throw the men in front of me off balance. Tyree was a college freshman from Washington, D.C. With infectious enthusiasm and boundless energy, he epitomized our mission. By training young people like Tyree, who would in turn encourage his peers to embrace his passions, we all hoped that Expedition Denali would inspire thousands of young people just like him. "Summit Team Yellow," I yelled. This was the code for our unit to slow down whenever any of us reached a switchback turn. Changing my ice axe to my uphill hand, I kick-stepped my way around it. "Summit Team Clear," I called when I was safely around the bend. I was doing better. Around 5 a.m., 2 hours into our hike, we entered a treacherous field of cracks that could swallow a person whole. Without the benefit of full daylight, it was impossible to see the crevasses clearly. On lead, in front of all the rope teams, Angela carefully probed the snow for any dangerous spots in the path before her. By checking with her axe for a solid surface beneath the snow and ice before every step, she ensured the safety of the entire team. It made for slow going, but it was far better than the alternative. As Angela found and stepped over each small traversable crevasse, she issued a warning shouted over her shoulder, alerting everyone to watch their step. My heart pounded as I carefully negotiated each deep fissure that split the glacier. Although most were only 18 inches wide, every crack opened like a gaping black maw and seemed to suck down the light from my headlamp, disappearing into infinity. As I straddled each one, I compulsively tightened my grip on my axe, ever ready to arrest a fall should it come. A few months earlier, marching across the Matanuska Glacier in the Chugach Range of Alaska, on our first significant training session, our team hadn't been so lucky. We'd already been in the Chugach for 10 days when we set off in our snowshoes toward our next campsite, linked together in four-person rope teams. Under an overcast sky with low visibility, the terrain consisted of little more than a vast monochromatic snowfield. The only distinguishing feature was the dark forms of our team, highlighted by flashes of pigment from the bright clothing, backpacks, and the ropes that bound us together. With virtually no scenery to enjoy, the walking was profoundly monotonous, and we were all lost in our thoughts when someone suddenly yelled, "Falling!" Without looking back, I braced myself for a tug on my rope that never came. All three of my teammates were accounted for. Relieved that my team was okay, I turned to check on the two teams in the rear. One remained standing, four dark silhouettes against a white backdrop. But three members of the second team lay face down in the snow, leaning heavily into their ice axes as an unseen weight pulled taut the ropes secured to their harnesses. The fourth member of their rope team, Alex Strauss, was simply gone, dangling with a 65-pound pack inside a crevasse of unknown depth. Alex was one of several other students in the same Knowles mountaineering course that was training members of Expedition Denali. Even though nine other climbers, including me, had already passed over the spot where Alex fell, for some unknown reason, the thin ice bridge that covered the crevasse collapsed under his weight. Fortunately, having trained for just such an emergency, the three remaining members of his rope team saved him from falling out of reach. To avoid risking another fall, the other student climbers stayed put while one of the instructors built a secure system of ropes and carabiners and safely hauled Alex out of the hole, a bit shaken but unharmed. After a few kind words of encouragement from our leaders, the rope teams fell back into line, and we continued toward our next camp on the Matanuska Glacier as if nothing had happened. Months later, we cleared the crevasse field below the summit of Mount Baker without incident, to continue along a frozen passage that grew brighter as the sun rose behind us. We marched onward into increasingly steep terrain as dawn unfolded all around us, until all at once we stopped. A long line of climbers intersected our path from the opposite direction, using a route from the west that was popular with commercial guides on Mount Baker. A team of 20 clients, roped into teams of six, trudged steadily up the base of the head wall, the steepest part of the climb. At the head of our rope team, Tyree gave way to the oncoming crowd, much to the consternation of Stephen Shope, the oldest and most experienced member of our group. Given our fewer numbers and greater speed, it was frustrating to grind to a halt with our goal within view. As I watched the party go by, I couldn't help but notice the broad array of ages, genders, relative fitness, and technical ability in their group. I imagined that they were all strangers to each other, and I couldn't help but to compare their experience to ours. Surely, they would make it to the summit, but each would likely experience it as an individual accomplishment. We, however, had climbed and would summit as a team, committed to a common purpose. Here on Mount Baker, the experience of being part of a team had opened my eyes to the physical challenges that lay ahead on Denali. But it also yielded a better understanding of what it meant to work cooperatively toward a shared goal. Though our objective was the top of a high mountain, our mission was to demonstrate that anyone, regardless of race, ethnicity, gender, or disability, can share in the satisfaction of climbing. By operating as a team, any summit, any goal, is achievable. Once the other group had cleared the head wall, we began our slow ascent along a narrow trail of switchbacks. Here, for the first time, we were fully exposed to the possibility of a longer and more dangerous fall should anyone slip. Though the view of the valley below was breathtaking, I kept my vision focused on the path in front of me, careful to keep pace with Tyree and Billy and mindful of the rope and the distance between us. Our crampons clicked against jagged rocks poking up here and there through the snow, threatening to catch a spike and trip us up. Then suddenly, our heads cleared the height of the head wall and revealed a flat expanse leading up to a granite dome. We stood in the middle of a saddle where several trails up the mountain converged. I could see yet another group of climbers in the distance making their way toward the summit. The sun shone down, providing actual warmth for the first time that day, and a gentle breeze stirred the air around us. We watched as the other climbers reached the summit and took pictures. A few minutes later, they came down, smiling and clutching their cameras. When the summit was at last clear, we made our way along the wide path to the peak. Each member of our party belayed the next to safety until all nine of us stood side by side on the volcanic dome. The morning sun warmed our faces as we gazed out over the Cascade Mountains and a sea of snow-capped peaks. We were still catching our breath, immersed in thought, when Adina pulled off her Gore-Tex shell. Underneath, she wore a silver sequin tank top over her Gore-Tex jacket. "Am I the only one who brought summit bling?" she asked. We erupted in a chorus of cheers, high fives, and adrenaline-fueled laughter. The wind howled with us as a sudden gust whirled around our dancing, crampon-clad feet. For almost 2 years before the planned 2013 Denali climb, Knowles put together these mountaineering missions to train and build the team that would ultimately attempt the biggest North American summit. Knowles had reached out to organizations around the country to find participants willing to join this ambitious project to bring more people of color into the outdoors. I was one of the many who answered the call. And a few months before our trips into the Chugach and Cascade Ranges, 17 of us, interested in Expedition Denali, gathered for the first time at a mountain cabin in Lake Tahoe, California. By 2009, I had produced a short documentary on diversity and outdoor recreation for the Public Radio International program, to the best of our knowledge. I had already written several magazine articles on the issue and was in the process of writing another specifically about diversity in the national park system when I took my first Knowles course through the Wind River Range of Wyoming. That was when I first met Knowles' newly hired diversity and inclusion manager, Aparna Roja Gopal Durbin. It was her idea to put together an all-African-American team for a high-profile expedition to the summit of Denali. When the time came to choose the team, she invited climbers who were also leaders of organizations committed to helping spread the message of diversity. As a journalist who'd written about diversity and outdoor recreation, I was part of that list. We were told from the outset that there would only be 9 slots on the Denali summit team. So we knew that not all of us would be going to Alaska. Our first workout in Lake Tahoe, composed of multiple rounds of calisthenics meant to boost our metabolic output, had caused a few to disqualify themselves. Three more fell away after we had spent 2 weeks training in the Matanuska Glacier, where Alex fell into the crevasse. Another few dropped out due to family or professional obligations, or simply the inability to commit so much time and energy to training. The final nine who remain, myself included, trained for the Denali climb as a team, each wanting to prove ourselves worthy of the mission. Mount Baker was the final test before Expedition Denali officially got underway 9 months later. The final list of Denali climbers would include only those who made it to the summit of Mount Baker. Technically, that included me. But with the mountain twice as high looming in the future, the climbers had to do more than just reach the Baker summit. They had to excel getting there. To achieve the summit on a climb where the price of failure could mean death, everyone needed to be capable of pulling their weight and making sacrifices when needed. Though it was crushing to admit it, after Mount Baker, I knew I was the weakest link. I might have been able to climb past my obvious physical limitations, but I had no business being on the summit team and potentially putting others at risk. Fortunately, the decision to quit was no longer mine to make. 2 days after summiting Mount Baker, the team traveled back to the Knowles Base in Conway, Washington, where the course.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.